God, praise God. Let the people of God say amen, amen. I welcome you to the Bread Broadcast, a Bible teaching program from Eternal Food Evangelistic Organization, where we edify, we exalt, and challenge believers to the Great Commission. Here, we also call sinners to repentance through the gospel of Jesus Christ. Thank you for joining us. And from the family of Eternal Food Ministry, we want to wish you a blessed and wonderful resurrection celebration. May the power of the resurrection of Jesus Christ come into your life and your home and resurrect every good thing that will make you to be who God has called you to be and to do what God has called you to do, in Jesus' name. Today, we are going to be talking about Calvary's preview in the Garden of Eden. That's like 4,000 years apart, according to Bible scholars. Calvary's preview in the Garden of Eden, and the case study is going to be the first bloodshed recorded in the Bible. So the first bloodshed. And the short reading for today, which is your assignment, is the Gospel according to John, chapter 3, verse 13 to 16. John 3, 13 to 16. But before we start to unpack our lesson, let's pray. Father, thank you. Jesus, thank you. Sweet, blessed Holy Spirit, thank you. Father, we love you. Thank you, Jesus, for releasing your life to pay the death penalty that we could have paid. You took our place in the court of judgment of God, so we will not go to hell. Thank you, Holy Spirit, for calling us to repentance, for upholding us. And Lord, for as many that will be watching and listening to this program, Father, I pray you minister to them, each and every one of them. Speak to them in the language they will understand, so this message can be burned into their hearts. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Our foundation text is Genesis chapter 3, verse 21. Chapter 3, verse 21. Also for Adam and his wife, the Lord God made tunics of skin or clothing of animal skin and clothed them. Now, like I said, between the Garden of Eden and Calvary, and now when I'm saying Calvary, I'm referring to the death of Jesus Christ on that cross. Between those two, Bible scholars put it for 4,000 years. But God in his infinite wisdom was giving us a preview of what's going to happen on the cross of Calvary through the killing of the animal in the Garden of Eden. So what was the first animal bloodshed to show us concerning what the blood of Jesus at Calvary would do? Number one, it was showing us that the blood of Jesus will atone our sin. The blood of the animal which God killed was to cover the sin of Adam and Eve until Jesus, the perfect sacrifice, who come to die on the cross for the removal of the sins of the world, starting from the sin of Adam, you see, because that was the primal sin, disobedience to God. God had to kill an animal which did nothing wrong for Adam and Eve who did something wrong. Watch this. Just as sinless, perfect Jesus died for sinful mankind, you see. However, unlike the blood of animals, which could only cover sin for 1 year And that's why they had to repeatedly, through the Old Testament, kill animals every year. Even today, the Jews, they still celebrate Yom Kippur. In September, I believe. You see, Yom Kippur is the highest holy day, the holiest day in the Jewish culture, because they call it the Day of Atonement. But Jesus became that atonement over 2,000 years ago, you see. So they had to offer animal sacrifices every year. But it was only good for 1 year. That would put the anger of God at bay for 1 year. Then they have to do it again. But the blood of Jesus was shed once and for all. Hallelujah. Not to cover our sin, watch this, but to wipe it off, to wipe off our sins from God's records. I like that. For everyone who believes in Jesus, it's only for those who believe in Jesus that their sins are wiped off God's records. But if you don't believe in Jesus, your sin still remains, as Jesus said. Your sin, every bad thing you've done that you're thinking nobody saw you, hey, they are written inside God's book, you see. And those sins are yet to be forgiven you. But that can change. And I will tell you how. Let's go to John 3:16. It's a very popular verse in the Bible. John 3:16. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. You see, that's how to change it. You believe in Jesus. You believe in the sacrifice that he made. You believe that you have nothing good enough of yourself, in yourself, to bring you to a perfect heaven. If you can believe that in your heart and you confess Jesus as the Son of God, the Bible says you will not perish. That is, you will not go to the damnation, eternal damnation of the lake of fire. But if you refuse, I hope you don't, and I pray you don't, but if you say, what are you talking about? It's mumbo jumbo. Listen up. It will be your sin and your stink and your sink. Let me say that slowly. If you fail and you refuse to accept Jesus, it's your sin, it's your stink, and it's going to be your sink. Moving on. The blood of Jesus has foreshadowed or previewed through the blood of the animal. It was pointing to let us know that the blood of Jesus is going to address our shame. God dealt with the shame of Adam and Eve's nakedness by covering them up. Don't you just love God? There was no mention of their nakedness again. Afterward, they went to have children, and it was through their children that it was first recorded in the Bible that humans worshipped God when Cain and Abel brought their offerings to God. Listen, that was what that animal blood was showing, previewing for us in the garden. This is how it actually played out and concerns us today. For anyone who surrenders their life to Jesus, the power of the glorious gospel of Christ Jesus covers a repentant sinner with God's glory, you see, instead of their old story. The glorious gospel of Jesus Christ is covering me as you are saying me. And that's why I can carry the Bible. And God said, Joseph and Zion, now that I've cleaned you, now that you have been washed in the blood of the Lamb, now I want you to be my mouthpiece. Go tell other people what I've done for you, you say. That is the power of the glory of the gospel. instead of my old story that I forget it. You see, the forgiveness we receive at salvation removes the load of sin from our shoulder, because the conscience is now clean and clear. You see, there is peace in the heart, and the joy of the Holy Spirit enters the heart of the believer. As a result, the shameful behaviors of the past loses its control in the life of a believer. And that shameful past is now replaced with the testimony of the relief that is now received in Christ Jesus. Listen up. The animal that God killed in the garden, with which the clothing from that animal was given to Adam and Eve as clothing. Listen, that animal couldn't do that for them. Oh no. It's just a shadow. You see, a shadow is not like the real thing. But when the real thing came, the blood of Jesus, we are able to get clean conscience, clear conscience, joy, peace, relief, no more load of sin, you see. We have a better covenant in Christ Jesus. Hallelujah. Acts 16:34. The book of Acts, chapter 16:34. And this is the story of the Philippian jailer, whom Paul and Silas, they preached to him, and he became a believer. And this is what happened after that. Now, when he had brought them, Paul and Silas, into his house, he set food before them, and he rejoiced. Why? Having believed in God with all his household. That's it. I've never met a new believer who was angry. Oh, no. The first thing everybody always says is either, oh, I feel light, or they start looking around like, oh, the colors have changed. Those are always the two things I've seen with new believers. When I gave my life to Jesus, I remember waking up, coming out of my house, the grass is green in a different way. The flower was, I'm like, what's going on? You see, he took your shame to the cross so you can take his fame to the world. Listen up. Don't say, Josephine Zion, I've done so many bad things. Listen up. As long as you are ready, Jesus has always been waiting for you. Oh, you have no idea how messed up my life is. Forget it. He will take the shame. He already took your shame, really. But he will take the consciousness of that shame from your spirit, and he will give you his glory from the gospel. He will exchange it. And you will now go back to all the people who have known you with your old lifestyle, and they will see that something has changed. Why? Because he took your shame to the cross so you can take his fame to the world. Don't you like that? Give him your shame. He will give you his fame. Amen. The third thing that the blood of Jesus did and is still doing for us, which the animal blood in the garden was pointing. Remember that. The animal blood could only point. It didn't do what the blood of Jesus is doing for us. No. It could only show this is what's going to happen. This is what's going to happen. This is what's going to happen, you see. The third thing was the blood of Jesus apprehended the shark. I like that. There's nowhere in the Bible where we read that the devil ever had contact with Adam and Eve again. No. The curses pronounced by God formed a spiritual barrier. God said, you woman, and you serpent, as from now, you're going to be enemy forever. You're going to be enemies. your seed and your seed, you're going to be enemies forever. And it has always been. You see, when you give your life to Jesus, and I'm not just telling you this story, this is something that happened to me, is happening to me, and so many believers. When you are saved, if indeed, listen up, you are saved, salvation brings enmity between you and the shark of sin. It has to be. Because now you are marked with the blood of Jesus. And the devil cannot stand the blood of Jesus. Hallelujah. Sin cannot stand the blood of Jesus. So once you have been saved and you are marked, the Bible says, when I see the blood, I will pass over you. You see. Once you have been marked with the blood of Jesus, now enmity starts. Because now you are swimming against the current, you see. The blood of Jesus supernaturally empowers believers to hate sin. We can do that on our own. Oh no. I used to lie before I became a Christian, but when I became a child of God, I don't even want to go there. Really, what happened? It's still the same person, but something has changed on the inside. The Holy Spirit is now in my heart. So the Holy Spirit has empowered me to say, no, Josephine Zion, you cannot lie. Even if telling the truth is going to bring you some trouble, you have to tell the truth, you see. The blood of Jesus empowers us to hate sin. No longer to continue living the previous lifestyle, which was enslaved, totally dominated, and ruled by sin. The power of sin is destroyed, you see. The blood, animal blood, could only push the anger of God away for 1 year. But when Jesus shed his own blood, he broke the back of the devil. Hallelujah. You see, the power of sin is destroyed. Now, this does not mean that the believer will become perfect. Oh, no. But the believer is more conscious of sin. I'm very careful not to deliberately sin. Big difference. Maybe out of anger, you call somebody an idiot. Now you have to repent, because the day God created that person, God didn't say, look at the idiot I made. No. But you were angry and you called that person an idiot, you see. So you are more conscious. A true believer becomes sorrowful whenever they slip into sin. That's how you know someone who has truly been born again. And we seek to repent quickly, so as to continue their fellowship or friendship with the Holy Spirit. Even the prodigal son, a time came for him. He came back to his senses, the Bible says. You see. So if someone is truly saved, they don't continue pursuing that lifestyle of sin, day in, day out, rolling into 1 year, 2 years, 3 years, 4 years. No. No. Because at birth, when we are newly born again in Christ Jesus, we have received the Holy Spirit that puts enmity between us and sin. Let's go to 1 John chapter 3, verse 9. 1 John, the epistle, chapter 3, verse 9. Whoever, listen up, this is the word of God, okay, has been born of God, does not sin. That is, you don't pursue a lifestyle of sin. For his seed remains in him. The Holy Spirit is in you. And he cannot sin because he has been born of God. You can't argue with the Bible. That is the Bible right there. If anybody says, oh, I used to be a Christian 5 years ago, but I lost it, tell them you never had it. You never had that faith? No. Because the Bible says, if you have been born of God, you would not be pursuing a lifestyle of sin. Why? Because the blood of Jesus broke the backbone of sin. The evil of Eden was ended by the bleeding of Jesus for you. The evil of Eden was ended by the bleeding of Jesus for you and for me. Praise God. Now, the blood was showing us, like I said, it's an indicator, a pointer. That's all it was doing. Showing us what's going to happen with the real blood of Jesus Christ. The blameless, spotless blood of Jesus. It was showing us that the blood of Jesus would approve our spots. The animal blood that God shed in the Garden of Eden exampled how we can come to heaven by the blood of Jesus. Watch this. Alone. Alone. Not because you fast 7 times a week. Not because you give your money to the poor. Not because you feed the hungry. Not because you pray for 7 hours a day. That's all good. But those are works. Anybody can do that. The Muslims, they do that. Unbelievers, they do that. Well, I've never smoked in my life. I've never committed fornication. Listen up. Moralists, they do that. Or I believe in God. Demons, they believe too, but they tremble, you see. Oh, I do miracles. I speak in tongues. Listen up. Jesus said, I'm going to tell them on that day, depart from me. I don't know you, you see. The only thing that you can be sure of 100% that if you die right now, you are going to heaven is the blood of Jesus. If you can say, I have been born again, I have been washed in the blood of Jesus, then your heaven is sure, you see. When Jesus said it is finished, he was saying paid in full. Tetelestai. That's what it means. Paid in full, you see. There is no more sacrifice needed by God to forgive mankind. No more. After the sacrifice of Jesus was received by God, God said, perfect, finished. That's it. The ticket to heaven, listen now, has been prepaid by Jesus. And heaven is now open for everyone who believes in Christ Jesus when they die. Are you a Mohammedan? Listen, if you can confess Jesus, you will go to heaven. Confess Jesus, believe in him, and receive him into your life. Are you a Buddhist? An atheist? A Hindu? Or you are independent? Listen, if you can confess Jesus, I'm not bringing religion to you. No, I am telling you about your future. What's going to happen? If you can confess Jesus and say, Lord Jesus, I have nothing good in me, but this lady said you did something that can bring me to heaven. I believe you are the Son of God, and I believe in what you did on the cross of Calvary. Forgive me. Listen up. Jesus said, I will not reject you. If you can do that and believe from the bottom of your heart. The only way to become spiritually perfect before God is to wear the garment of the blood of Jesus alone. That's it. How do you do that? I just went over it when I was explaining. You ask Jesus to forgive you your sins. Ask him to begin to direct your life. Promise that you'll be obeying everything he tells you. And this is how he instructs you through the Bible. So that means you'll be obeying the Bible from now on. This is called being born again. That's what it means, you see. If you do that, that means you have been born again. If you genuinely did so from your heart, it's got to be from right here, not just lip service, no. John 3:3, this is Jesus himself speaking, so you want to listen. John 3:3, Jesus answered and said to him, he was talking to Nicodemus, most assuredly I say to you, unless one is born again, there goes our word, he cannot see the kingdom of God. Now you know the meaning of being born again. Now Jesus is saying, if you are not born again, you are not going to heaven. And for anyone who doesn't go to heaven, there's only one place left, hell, the lake of fire. And he doesn't want you to go there. And you don't even want to go there. So the only option, the only intelligent choice, really, that you have before you is to be born again. To declare spiritual bankruptcy is to receive heaven's life policy. Let me say that very slowly. To declare spiritual bankruptcy is to receive heaven's life policy. So, what have we done so far? How did the animal bloodshed in Eden previewed Calvary? The animal blood in the Garden of Eden previewed that Jesus' blood would atone our sin, that our sins can only be erased by the blood of Jesus. Address our shame. Accepting Jesus replaces the shame of sinful past with clear and clean conscience, with joy and peace in the Holy Spirit. Apprehend the shark. Divine enmity comes between us and sin once we become saved. Approve our spot. We now have the hope of eternity in heaven because of faith in Jesus and his shed blood. As a believer, who has the Holy Spirit inside of you if you have been born again? Do you endeavor to share this life and death truth with unbelievers that you know? Do you? If you don't, there's never a better time to start than this time of Easter. Let them know the meaning of the resurrection that they are celebrating. Now, if you're an unbeliever, listen. I want you to know that you and I are naturally born with the natural inclination to do wrong things. To sin is very easy. Sin is like sugar to the tongue. It's sweet, right? On our own, we cannot obey God. It's impossible. Because it is tasteless to our humanness. The root of every sin is disobedience against God. Have you ever done something wrong and your conscience pricked you? That's because you just disobeyed God. So that means you are not perfect. This is our nature by birth, our condition by choice, and our position by God's divine declaration. God's verdict is, listen up, no sinner will come to heaven. However, Jesus paid the death penalty for your sins and for mine, and I received it, you see, so I'm going to heaven. Are you? He did that because he loves you and he loves me. If you will confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead, you will be saved. If you are ready to do that, I'm going to say a quick prayer. And a link is coming up. Follow that link. We'll meet you there. Father, we thank you. Sweet, blessed Holy Spirit, thank you for speaking through me. Father, let your power rest upon this message, O Lord. And let it prosper in the lives of everyone who have listened to it. Give restlessness to those who are yet to make up their minds to vote for Jesus. But upon your children who have already been born again, let your peace abide. In Jesus' name, amen. I will see you next week, only if Jesus has not split the sky open.